Our next speaker is going to be Father Paul Sullins, who is also Dr. Paul Sullins. He's a Ph.D. in sociology. He taught at the Catholic University of America for a number of years and recently retired from there. And his research came to my attention a few years ago because he began working on the impact of same-sex parenting on children. And that was a big issue in the debates over redefining marriage, as you may remember. And so I was following his research fairly closely. And when he retired, he was looking for some way to continue his research in this area. And he called me up, and we were talking about it and so on. I finally decided, well, why don't you come work for me? You know, and so therefore you can continue doing this very, very important research. And I said, you know, is there really any more to be done on this? And he said, you know what? It's just getting started. Honestly, the research on same-sex parenting is just beginning. Because now that it's legal, now that the marriage has been redefined, there will be more people doing it. You'll have more instances of children being raised by same-sex couples. You'll have more data being collected and people asking the questions. So there's really more work to be done now than ever because we are finally having some systematic data that can be studied. So on that basis, we said, well, sure, you know, why don't you come on? So that's what we did. And then that was, I guess that was about a year ago, about April, I want to say about a year ago. And then last summer, all of the clergy sexual abuse scandal hit again, broke again in the Catholic Church. And I was trying to refute some people online, talk about things online. We were talking, and I said, Father Sullins, are you familiar with the John Jay Report? Because the John Jay Report was the study of clergy sexual abuse that was done in 2004 and 2011. And I was trying to make some arguments about that data. And I said, are you familiar with this? And he goes, are you kidding me? Of course I know the John Jay Report. You know, he's a sociologist, for crying out loud. Yeah, of course he knew everything about it. And we began talking about it. And of course I was interpreting it correctly. And he straightened me out a little bit on a few things and so on. And then he said, you know what we could do? No, what could we do? We could take the Pennsylvania Grand Jury Report, which came out last summer. All of you who are Catholic are, you know exactly what I'm talking about, that detailed report of sexual abuse in the state of Pennsylvania. We could take that and we could turn it into data. We could codify it so that we could make a data set out of those, you know, kind of whatever it was, 1,100 cases that were in there. Instead of it just being a bunch of stories, we could code it. And I said, really? You could do that? And he went, yeah. So anyway, that's what he did. And he engaged a few students to do the codification, and then he started analyzing it. And so he wrote the report that has become known sometimes, some circles, it's known as the Sullins Report, or it's the Ruth Institute Report on Clergy Sexual Abuse and the Relation Between That and Homosexual Clergy. And that is, the summary of that report is in your bags, if you want to see what that's about. But that just is the story of how that came about, that Father Sullins, working with the Ruth Institute, created this work, and here we are. So now, only now do we start the clock.
Oh, all right. Oh, you got your clock.
You
okay.
got a full 40 minutes starting now.
Well, let me just say that report, the Sullins or Ruth report, came out a week before last in the National Catholic Bioethics Quarterly. And they were kind enough to send me, unsolicited, 25 reprints of that, very nicely bound ones. And they're on the Ruth Institute table back there. They're free for the taking. So if you would like your own copy of that Sullins report, you're welcome to it here. I'm very, very pleased and honored to be with you all today, this afternoon at this conference. My wife and I have been here for the whole conference, and we have learned so much. And I hope to add a little bit to that today. I have to say that the speakers, if they had gotten together and tried to figure out how to be a good setup for what I'm about to share, they couldn't have done a better job. Dr. Gagnon, what a wonderful preacher he is. He's like the Energizer Bunny of preachers. He just goes on and on, and it's all great. I almost wanted to say, look, let's just skip me and let him keep on going. But are you familiar with the distinction between special revelation and natural revelation? It's what's revealed by God in the scriptures, and then what's revealed by God in creation and nature, the book of the Bible and the book of nature. And it's so great because he's presented to you the book of the Bible, and I'm going to now present to you on the very same topics, the book of nature. And today we study nature by reason and experience in science. Pope Francis tells us that there's a global war on marriage. That's not news to this group here, gathered in Louisiana. It may surprise some of you to know that Pope Francis is saying this, I've found, but he is very clear about this. It's not a physical war of weapons, but a war of ideas. It's an ideological colonization that's trying to destroy the family by efforts to redefine the very institution of marriage. This attack on the family, he says, is based on a demonic gender ideology that denies the order of creation as expressed in the complementarity of man and woman. On one side of the war is the natural idea of marriage we've heard a lot about already. This definition of marriage speaks of one man and one woman who engage in a natural, conjugal, sexual relationship ordered by a covenant designed to ensure their own mutual good in the procreation and education of their offspring. They give themselves to one another wholly, exclusively, and permanently, as we have heard. Catholics believe that Jesus elevated this covenant to a sacrament, but he didn't invent it. It's based upon the natural sexual differentiation and consequent fertility of the human race that, as we have just heard, comes from creation. On the other side is this new idea of marriage as a committed relationship. Evan Wolfson, who's one of the central leaders of the gay marriage movement, published a book back in 2003, I think it was, called Why Marriage Matters. And in this book, he defined marriage as a relationship of emotional and financial interdependence legitimized by a public commitment. This is exactly the kind of marriage as a committed relationship that is sought in gay marriage. It was granted in those exact words in the 2012 court ruling legalizing marriage in California, and later in the 2015 Obergefell decision legalizing marriage nationwide. So what's the difference between these two definitions? As we have already heard today, conjugal marriage asks the desires of adults to take second place to the needs of children. Committed relationship marriage asks the needs of children to take second place to the desires of adults. The possibility of children is built into a conjugal relationship, but in a CR relationship, children are external. They're kind of an add-on if you want them. Now, in fact, as an empirical scientific fact, almost all heterosexual marriages, over 90% of them, do actually produce children. And at any given time, over half of heterosexual marriages have children in the home. But same-sex couples never conceive children, and only a fraction of them have children in the home. About a quarter of lesbian couples and about half that many, 12-13% of gay male couples, ever have children in the home. From a Catholic or a natural law understanding, the absence of sexual difference in same-sex couples creates an environment that is not conducive to the full human development of children. The statement on the screen now is from Pope Benedict in 2005. It was recently strongly reaffirmed by Francis, and it continues on a stream of statements by all of the popes in the magisterial tradition, going back a long ways. Now, I take this claim of the church as evidence for my research. I'm sorry, not as evidence, as a hypothesis for my research. I said to myself, well, let's find out if this is supported by the evidence. And this is what I found. You're looking at the results from the United States National Health Interview Survey, which is the largest public health survey in the world. It's based on a random sample of over 200,000 American children. In this study, I compared child outcomes on the Strength and Difficulties Questionnaire, the SDQ, as it shows on the slide. This is the most widely used predictor of clinically significant emotional distress for children, such as depression, anxiety disorder, hyperactivity. The red bars are the children with opposite sex parents. And the blue bars are the children with same-sex parents. And you can see on all of these measures that the blue bars are a lot higher than the red bars. The percentage of children who have clinically significant emotional problems is much, much higher for children who have same-sex parents. Here on this SDQ measure, I find that 7.4% of children with opposite-sex parents will develop some sort of emotional problem. But with same-sex parents, it's 17.4%, about 2.5 times as many. And that's called the risk factor for emotional distress with same-sex parents. The SDQ now is based on parent ratings of child's emotional health. It's a really good measure. It was created by the Harvard Institute of Public Health. It's used on all the World Health Organization surveys. It's a very good predictor of child emotional distress, but it is based on parents' ratings of their own children. And we know that when parents rate their own children, sometimes parents don't see the downside of their children quite as much as other people. If anybody's ever taught school and had parent conferences, you know that that can happen. They want to make themselves and their children look good. That's called social desirability bias. So I looked at some other questions which considered more objective because they asked parents to report the opinion of someone else or some event that happened and not just to express an opinion. So these two bars ask the question, has your child actually received a diagnosis of a developmental disability or an intellectual disability or an emotional disability? And you can see that a little bit higher percentage of parents will admit to a diagnosis. That's that social desirability bias. So you got 7.4%. Here it's more, 10.2%. Say, well, yeah, we've actually received a diagnosis. But you still see this same division between the children with same-sex parents, children with opposite-sex parents, about twice as many. These two questions, has your child in the past year received any sort of medical treatment for an emotional problem or been prescribed drugs for an emotional problem? So again, the parent is a little more objective. They're reporting an experience or an event. And you can see that although there's some differences, you still have much higher rates with the same-sex parents. Here it's a little bit less than twice as many that report receiving treatment. It's over three times as many with same-sex parents that report their child has received some sort of psychotropic medication in the past year. These findings confirm that children have more emotional problems with same-sex parents. But they don't tell us why that's the case or what it is about having two parents of the same sex that might lead to greater problems. Now, church teaching in line with natural law theories have an opinion about this too. This is the encyclical Donum Vitae, 1987, and it asserts that what enables a child's proper development is the care, not just of heterosexual parents, not just of complementary parents, but a really important point, and some of you made this earlier, it's the child's own parents. It's his or her own biological parents in a secure relationship. In God's plan, each child should have the care of the very two persons whose conjugal love, of whom conjugal love, that child is the fruit or the expression. That's what God has in mind, according to the church and according to most natural law theories. Recently, Pope Francis reiterated this idea strongly. I mentioned this earlier, and somebody said, I don't believe Francis really said that. Well, here it is from Amoris Laetitia. He says that both the child's mother and father are necessary for his or her integral and harmonious development. So I have this kind of image as we move away from intact married parents, as we categorize things empirically in the social sciences, we move away from the presence of the biological or own parents of the child. We have a sort of increasing defection from the natural order. We move to separated, recombined, unstable, or single heterosexual parents. These are all less consistent with the natural or the godly design. And then the same-sex parents are the least natural of all the family forms on offer. That's why they're the first listed in the lists of the violations of God's design. If having his or her own conjugal parents matters for child's well-being, then all other things equal, child well-being should be lower with same-sex parents than with any of these other heterosexual family forms. So you get the idea. That's the hypothesis that I'm drawing from this. It's a really strong claim. It claims not only that there's a difference, but that there's also going to be a greater difference than brought about by these other defects from the family forms. Well, let's see if it's true. So I test this idea here. This is the same data set, National Health Interview Survey. And here I find that the three left bars are three types of heterosexual relationships. The first one, it is the closest we can get by social science measures to the conjugal ideal, two married biological parents in a kind of intact marriage. The next three forms have heterosexual parents but defect from the ideal in some way. In the step-parent family, the child has heterosexual parents, but one of the parents is not his or her own parent. With cohabiting partners, the partners are not permanently committed, so relationships are less stable or secure for that child. With a single parent, the child has only one of his or her own biological parents. And you can see, indeed, there is increasing child distress with each of these family forms as they move away from that conjugal ideal. Then we move to same-sex parents, and we get a great increase in distress, almost twice, not quite twice as much. It's much, much higher. The rate of distress with same-sex parents here is almost four times what it is with two married biological parents. So this seems to provide support for that very claim that the church is making. Another way of testing this idea would be to just look directly at the presence of biological or the child's own parents directly. And here we see that the children with both biological parents have the lowest rate of emotional problems. In fact, the lowest rate that we've seen so far in this presentation, 4.3% of children who are living with both of their biological parents are predicted to have some rate of clinically significant emotional distress, about 1 in 20. And that proportion more than doubles if you take away one of those biological parents. And you either leave that a single parent or you try and replace it with another non-biological parent. We've heard all of the talk about divorced families and divorce split parenting arrangements today. That's the people that would be in this category here. And then if you move to no biological parents, it doubles again, right? Now, I put on this bar, just for you wonks out there, or geeks, I guess we call them, the error bars here. And you can see that there are higher error bars here, but they don't come anywhere close together. All of the differences that I'm presenting you today are highly statistically significant. If you're into the math of this, they're significant at the 0.01 level or higher, which means there's less than one chance in 100 that these are fake or illusory differences. They're very, very strong findings here. So this chart makes the point that just as Donum Vitae predicts, the presence or absence of conjugal parents is extremely powerful for child well-being. Now, I want to say, as an aside, I tested lots of other predictions or theories for why children may have higher difficulties with same-sex parents. I tested stigmatization, bullying of children, the stigmatization of parents, greater mental health issues for the parents, and whether that translated into greater mental health issues for the children. Family stability, I tested. All of those had some effect. But once I put in this factor of biological parentage, all those other factors went away. This explained all the variation between them and rendered all of those other ideas not important or not significant. It's not that they're not important in and of themselves, but once you separate children from their two own biological parents, it doesn't matter a whole lot, these other factors. That just kind of swamps everything else. The reason that same-sex parents don't have better outcomes for children is simply that none of them can ever be in the both bio parents category. About three-fourths of them are in the one bio parent category. That's this one here. And about the other quarter are in this category. There are zero same-sex parents down here. So clearly, and about two-thirds of children with heterosexual parents are down here. So clearly, there's going to be much lower rate of distress with heterosexual parents. So for children, gay marriage accomplishes the exact opposite of conjugal marriage. Conjugal marriage as a social arrangement assures to a child as much as possible the secure care of both of his or her biological parents. Gay marriage assures to a child that he or she will never have the care of both his or her biological parents. It is the opposite, in a way, for children of actual natural marriage. So now I'm going to switch gears. I was asked to talk about two different topics, same-sex parenting and clergy sex abuse. So we're just going to have to really, now for something completely different, as they say. I want to talk about the Catholic clergy sex abuse. Well, I don't know if I need to dwell on this too much. You know, if you're Catholic, that we have a problem, a sex abuse problem that sprang up last summer. We thought that we had put this behind us a long time ago and found out that it's still with us. In a way, it's been covered up. And even that some senior clerics in the church have been engaged in unspeakable, almost unthinkable, horrific abuse, sodomization of young men and of children. The bishops, you know, commissioned the John Jay Report from the John Jay College of Criminal Justice to collect data and report. This is kind of the summary trend that's reported in the first John Jay Report in 2004, and it shows a 50-year wave of the sex abuse of minor children that peaked along about the late 1970s, early 1980s, and has now declined. What was really unique and striking about the sex abuse in the Catholic Church is that 81% of the victims are boys. And I have here this slide. This is the Child Sex Abuse CSA in the Catholic Church. 81% of the victims are boys. And what's striking about that is that in American society at large, it's exactly the opposite. The Congress has authorized several studies on the incidence of sex abuse in the last 20, 30 years. This reports from these studies. This is from the fourth National Incidence Study of Child Abuse and Neglect. Put out by the U.S. government, tells us that nationwide, 80% of the victims of male sex abusers are girls. Girls are four times more likely to be sex abused as a child in American society generally, but in the Catholic Church, it's the opposite. Boys were four times more likely. So that suggests, prima facie to a number of people, that we may have homosexual abusers, men who seek preferentially to abuse boys rather than girls. Now, for various reasons, the John Jay reports rejected that, mostly because the trend of the abuse did not correlate with the trend, as they saw it, of men who were entering into the Catholic priesthood. And so I reanalyze that finding. well, here, I just can skip that. One error that they made is that they used the entire set of allegations to look at the possible correlation of those two trends. And the problem with that is that the allegations are highly retrospective. 80% of the allegations are retrospective, and not that means they look backwards in time. And so it's people today that were reporting abuse that happened to them a long time ago. You know how long ago? The average is 28 and a half years. Well, if you have a set of reports, most of which look back three decades or longer, and you see here, the red bars here is that trend. It comes down to almost nothing in the present day. Well, why does it do that? Because we're looking back 30 years or so on average. So how can we possibly know how much abuse we have today? We wouldn't know that unless we could time travel 30 years into the future and see all the reports people are making then about the abuse that happened now. Then we would have an accurate measure of that. So I correct for that. I only look at the reports of abuse that has happened in the past year. So I get rid of all the retrospective allegations, and I have this trend that's in the blue bars, right? You can see it a little easier here because this is just the blue bars. And here you can see that abuse has declined, but not nearly as much as with the red bars. And you can also see that the peak of the trend has moved forward in time. Because if you have that kind of skew, that retrospective skew, it makes the peak look earlier than it really was. So to measure the homosexual priests, I use a survey that was done in 2002 by the Los Angeles Times. Here's the question that they used to measure sexual orientation. And you can see that in 2002, 15% of priests reported that they had a homosexual orientation. They use a modified version of the Kinsey scale. That's okay. Which is kind of a standard measure of homosexuality. So here it reports from that survey the findings on the number of homosexual men in the Catholic priesthood. By 1965, you can see that starting back here in the 1950s, you had under 5% of men reported a homosexual orientation. And then it started rising by the mid-1960s. You have 1 in 5 priests who are being ordained who reported, thank you. All right, a homosexual orientation. And then in the 1980s, it did shoot up. It got much higher, as the John Jay report told us. 1 in 3 men who were ordained between 1980 and 1984 had a homosexual orientation. And then it started to drop, okay? So this is the trend of the entry of homosexual men into the Catholic priesthood. This line here aggregates all of the bars to the left, going backwards. And so it gives us the percentage of men who were in the priesthood at any point in time who are homosexual. So this would say, for instance, that 33% of men ordained during this period were homosexual, and 15% of all priests during this period were homosexual. And you can see as we ordained more and more of them, this percentage went up. The highest it attained was about 16%. By the early 1990s. Here, I overlay these two trends, the trends in abuse, right, the blue bars that go up and down, and the trends in the percent of homosexual priests. And the correlation between these two trends is a 0.90 correlation. It's a very strong correlation. Positive correlations run from 0 to 1. If it's a 1, it's a perfect correlation. Strongest you can get, so 0.90 is pretty close to as strong as you can get. Now remember, the John Day report said that if these two were associated, it would give us reason to believe that the abuse was due, at least in part, to the presence of homosexual men in the priesthood. So based on that argument, it looks from this evidence that is the case. If you break out the numbers by year instead of five-year groups, which is a better measure, so, you know, there's a weakness in this measure. If you read the paper, I spend several pages telling you what's wrong with this, what's missing from this. And one is that I aggregate them in five-year periods. It may make it look like a stronger association than it is. And this is a correlation with the incidence of abuse. It's not a correlation with the abuse of boys, right, as opposed to girls. You really should look at that one. So that's what I do here in this slide. And I find that when I do that, by use single-year measures and talk about the percent of male victims, it's an even stronger correlation. It's a 0.98. Now, what's perfect? 1.0. You really can't get any closer to a perfect correlation with this. So it seems to me that on this evidence, we would have to say that there is a relationship between having more homosexual-oriented men in the priesthood at any particular time, and more boys than girls being abused at any particular time. Well, this is certainly not the final word on this question. There are lots of other factors that enter in. But the point that this makes is that we're not going to really be able to solve this problem if we deny this important element among the set of conditions that brought about the horrific abuse of children, mostly boys, in the Catholic Church, in Catholic settings. Thank you for your attention and participation. I appreciate it. Now, I've zipped through this at grease lightning speed because I'm hoping to get some good questions and we can focus on things that you'd like to talk about, if possible.
If people have any questions, jot them down real quick, and I will start I'll start by making a couple of announcements that will tide us over.
Yeah.
We're going to have after this another break, and then we'll have another testimony panel after the break, and then I will give the closing talk and the closing ceremony. So you don't want to leave. Of course, nobody wants to leave. People are coming back. People have been leaving and coming back because they had obligations, but they really wanted to come back and be here. But I do want to let people know that during the break will be the last chance to do interviews with Chad and Don back there. So when that time comes and you want to be interviewed, zip over there and get yourself on Darlene's list, and we'll deal with that. And so do start jotting down questions if people have them. Bring them up here. I'm just going to mention that the live stream problems that we had last night have been resolved this morning, and so the morning show, I guess you call it, the panels that we had this morning, we had 1,300 people watching that live stream this morning. So isn't that great? Yeah. So all these videos will end up permanently online, so you can share them with others and whatever educational context or whatever activist context you might have for wanting to share that. That's all available. So do you want to go ahead with your you got a few questions here? You go right ahead.
I have one question. It's a really good question. It says, "Is this about homosexuality, clericalism?" Abuse of power. And you know, if you've listened to the discussions in the church, that's the other suggestion that's made when you bring up the issue, well, this could be about homosexuality or homosexual priests. I don't like to say that it's about homosexuality, because that kind of creates a substantive idea of homosexuality as this thing that is out there, or this, you know, reality that's out there. The church, you know, Catholic Church really doesn't subscribe to the idea that there is such a thing as homosexuality. There are persons who have, the magisterial documents say, homosexual tendencies or homosexual inclinations. It never says orientation or even condition, right? But putting that aside, is this about homosexuality or clericalism? And, you know, it's interesting. Some folk who say it's clericalism say, well, I'm showing a very strong correlation, but correlation is not causation, right? And I agree with that. It's not my theory that this correlation would lead us to think that homosexual priests had some causative effect on the abuse of boys. That's the theory of the John Jay report. I happen to agree with that. I think it makes a lot of sense. I don't know what kind of theory you would need to have to put it together in your mind that you have lots of boys being abused rather than girls, and you have a pretty good concentration of men who tell us they're homosexual rather than heterosexual, right? In the U.S. population, we have about 1.8% of men who are homosexual. In the Catholic priesthood, we had about 16%, about eight times as many. So I think that, it doesn't take a whole lot of thought to put those two things together in a causative way. And obviously, if you're going to put them together in a causative way, you have to say, well, it's not the abuse of boys that turn men homosexual. I haven't ever heard any of that, but it's probably having a preference for boys that would lead to greater abuse of boys. But I will say this. A correlation is not causation is not the right way to express that. We learned this from Aristotle. Is correlation by itself does not establish a causal effect. But in fact, you have to have a correlation in order to talk about causation. Correlation is a necessary but not a sufficient condition to establish causation, right? If two things don't go together, you really can't talk about any efficient causation between those two. So when someone says, well, this is clericalism, I want to say, well, what's the correlation between clericalism and clergy sex abuse? I would go back to this slide right here. This is what you got to correlate with. So are you suggesting that clericalism was very, very low before Vatican II? And then after Vatican II, we had this big rise in clericalism, and now it's dropped to almost nothing today? I mean, if that's what you want to suggest, then you could talk about clericalism. But everything I know about clericalism or clerical privilege in the church would tell us that it was the exact opposite. People say, well, we had too much clerical privilege, and then Vatican II brought about the increased collaboration with the laity and parish councils and people getting more involved in the church and the full conscious act of participation in the liturgy. It went in the opposite direction of clericalism, and now we might have an increase of it. I don't really know. So there's no correlation that I can see with clericalism. Thank you for that question.
Okay, so we're now getting a nice little backlog of questions here, Father, and we've got a couple here that are specific to Catholic things. About 20 years ago, the USCCB said sexual orientation is something you are born with. Has that statement been withdrawn?
Yes. And that was in, I think that's referring to the first edition of the Catechism of the Catholic Church. It didn't say something you were born with, but it says some people have this inclination despite their own choices or something of that nature. And that was challenged. And in the second edition of the Catechism, it revised it to say that the origin of these homosexual inclinations is unknown. And so it softened that. In fact, I could give you another whole 40 minutes on why homosexuality is not innate. We know a lot about right. the etiology of same-sex attraction today. And it's there is a genetic influence. It's somewhere between 25 and 35% heritability, which means it's somewhere between, how can I do the math here, 65 and 75% non-heritable. So it's not quite fair to say that homosexuality is a choice. It's not certainly a free or conscious choice for many people, but it's certainly not innate either.
Right.
I compare it to adoption of your native tongue. Growing up speaking the English language, right? I don't think anyone's hardwired to speak English or Spanish or whatever your language of origin is, right? But I would ask you, when did you make your choice to speak English, right? Did you make a conscious choice? No. You've discovered yourself to be an English speaker at some point growing up. And so there are lots of things that we can discover about ourselves. It seems like we're born that way. Right, I was born speaking English, but I really wasn't. I learned it through early socialization. So there are lots of things that, in personal experience, people will report to us. Well, I was this way. I found discovered this in my life, but they're really not genetically programmed in us.
And it's certainly not an immutable trait like race,
no.
which was what the legal strategy required for it to be
right.
something comparable to race, so that the whole anti-discrimination apparatus of law could be imported into that area.
Yes.
Here's a question. I sorted through and picked one that I think will be your favorite.
Oh, okay.
Because I know what you're thinking about.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
See?
We can, right, we could announce here, we have a follow-up study to this that addresses sex abuse up to the current time. And I don't want to reveal too much of that, but...
Oh, go ahead.
Oh, okay.
Here, read them the question.
The question is, what is the projection of the clergy abuse of boys now and in the near future, and what are the seminaries doing about candidates for ordination who profess a same-sex attraction? You saw this trend of homosexual priests right here. From the 1980s, it started to drop. And by the end of the last century, we had already dropped. We had fewer than half as many homosexual men being ordained. Now, what do you think if we projected this trend on into the future, you know, off the right edge of the slide here, what would that be? And so I've gotten some data and looked at that, and I'm pleased to tell you that as far as I can tell, I could be wrong about this, but as far as I can tell, we have been ordaining very few homosexual men in this century. For a number of reasons. One of the biggest reasons is that we have younger priests who have been put in charge of vocations and of seminaries. We have what a so-called clergy shortage, and so what bishops want to do is to attract young men so they get these younger, stylish priests who can relate to young people. And those younger stylish priests also happen to be what we would call the John Paul II breed of priests. And they read the church teachings and they follow them. Do you know how many homosexual men should be admitted to the Catholic priesthood according to the long and constant teaching of the church? It's really clear. Zero. There's no pope, including Pope Francis, who has ever supported more than zero homosexual men being ordained. And so they're faithful to that. And so we have, I can't find a trend in the population data of ordaining any homosexual men. I'm sure it's not that low. But so what has happened is that the abuse in the Catholic Church, and I should have put this slide up to if I can go ahead and reveal things, but the abuse of boys has dropped through the floor. And the abuse, we do have sexual abuse in the Catholic Church, and we have a disturbingly rising rate of sexual abuse, but it looks more like abuse in the general society today. Most of the victims, the vast majority of victims today, are female, not male. And we have a much lower rate of abuse than we've had in the past. So that's good news, and you'll be hearing more about that because we're going to release a whole new study that will give you all the details of that sometime, whenever Dr. Morse allows that to happen. Okay, thank you.
Thank you so much, Father Paul Sullins. This is great material, really great material. Like I said last night, if there are two things you think about the Ruth Institute, the first one is they know what they're talking about. Right? We're not shooting from the hip over here, right? Okay.